Hello everyone, welcome to this Advanced C programming class. One of the prerequisites for this class is an understanding of basic C programming. This course is going to be a very detailed course. A lot of people I have interacted with in the last 10 years, and I have seen that many people do have a concepts about C programming, but when we give them some slightly difficult task to accomplish, then we learn that they don't have a very good practical knowledge about C. Moreover, this course is going to cover in-depth coverage on C language. We start from basic, we go to a very deep level actually, okay? But if you have a preliminary knowledge of C programming, then it is going to be very helpful. Before I can really go into the depth of C, right, I would like you to have a piece of paper and a pen with you, because I am going to show you some programs. You are supposed to read that program, try to see what will be the output of that program. So some of these programs require very good understanding of C language. Okay, so there are very small program snippets. Try to see where you stand. If you are able to really get the answer right with a solid logic, then I can assume that yes, you know a good amount of C programming. If you are not able to get the answers right, then don't worry, because we are going to explain in complete detail about lot of these program as this particular course goes on and on. Okay, thank you. So here we go. Look into the first particular example. So I know you are reading this. You have standard stdio.h, and it's a very simple printf statements for people who wanted to understand this, right? So let's make a guess. What should be the answer? Size of integer greater than minus 1. Will it be true or will it be false? Make a note in a piece of paper. Let's move on to the second example. So again, a very small, simple example. We have a float data type f 0.1, and we are comparing that 0.1 with a 0.1, right? So we are comparing f with 0.1, and we will see whether the result is true and false. Let's go to another one. So in this example, you have variables a, b, c, integers, and we are trying to do some arithmetic operations, assignment, and some calculations using size of. Please make a note, or please pause this video for 5 to 10 seconds, analyze this particular code, and try to see the answers for a and b and c, and then we'll visit it in a short while. Okay, so let's move to the next example. Other one, so you have a character pointer p pointing to 0, and then we are trying to assign a value a here. It's a character a, right? So we are assigning character a into this, and at last it's a printf. So you are displaying the value. Again, make a note, what should the value? You can always pause the screen and then resume it. Let's go to the last example. So again, here we have a nice if conditions, right? It's kind of a nested if condition loop. So what you see here is a equals to 1, b is 3, and c equal to 2. And then you have a bunch of if conditions, and then the else condition. Make a note, analyze this code. I'll give you 2 seconds. You can pause it, resume. All right, so I think this is the first set of 5 examples in which I have tried to gauge your understanding, where you can understand some of these code, and try to deduce the answers, you know, try to arrive at your answers based on your current knowledge of C programming. As you move along, I'm going to answer most of these, okay, and I'll also give some solid reason as and when this topic comes in our deep course on advanced C programming, okay. And I will run this code on our system, and then we'll move on from there. As I talked in my presentation, I have given you five different lab exercises. So let's look into this exercise one by one. So I am just going to show you. Let's look into the first example. Okay, so I'm going to show you one by one each of these examples. This is the first code snippet. Size of integer, is it greater than 1? If so, then you have to do a true or else false. Most of the students, when they look into this code, they will try to deduce, they will try to understand what will be the size of integer. As many of us already know that size of integer is 4 on a 32-bit system, and also on a 64-bit environment, you will see it's again 4, right? So we will have a natural outcome as 4. Is it greater than minus 1? The answer will always be yes, because 4 is always greater than minus 1, right? However, when we run this code, when we compile and run this code, you will see a very different answer. Let's run this code now. So you are seeing the answer is false. So was it a, what is this main thing because of which we are seeing a different answer? So one of the important thing that we have kind of overlooked here is size of, what does it return? And then you have a comparison operator, and then you have a minus one, right? So as per C programming language rules, whenever you have a operator, this is a comparison operator, right? The operands must be of same data type, okay? They must be of same data type. So what is the data type of size of integer? Any guess? Will it be an integer or unsigned integer or unsigned long? So we have one of these. So in reality, when you look into size of integer, right? So size of always return an unsigned type. It's always an unsigned type. So it's an unsigned number. So it's an unsigned long number basically, right? Now what is minus one? Minus was in one, minus one is a signed integer. So you have a, you have to now choose between an unsigned versus signed entity, right? So when you have a binary operator with two operands, the both of them have to agree on the data type. And then if it is one of them is unsigned, the other one will be treated as an unsigned, okay? When we treat the other one as unsigned, then minus one as an unsigned value is one of the largest number. We convert it, is like FF, and I'm just writing for a 32-bit, right? If you do on a 64-bit, you can keep on adding FF. So this is one of the largest number basically that you can store. So now the entire equation boils down to size of integer is 4. Is 4 greater than such a large such a large number? Obviously the answer is not true, right? So I think this is what has happened behind the scenes. This is definitely 4 and this is minus 1. But because of the rules of the C language, for any operator, binary operator now, right? The operands must be of same data type. Since this is an unsigned value, this also has to be treated like an unsigned value. As you all know, minus one in memory is FF, and so on, depending on whether it's an integer or a long, right? And then when you do a size of this, 4 is never going to be greater than such a large number. And hence, the result will be a false. I hope you got a clarity. Try to read it little bit more about various conversion rules for C programming language. Okay, and from my side, when I jump into that topic of rules of conversion, I'm also going to revisit this particular example and little more about it. All right, thank you. Now let's look into the second example. What was the second one? Second one was floating, right? So let me clear the screen and we look into the code. So here also, when you see this on the face of it, when you run this code, everybody or a lot of people will assume that the answer should be true, because we are assigning a 0.1 to a f, and then we are comparing 0.1 to 0.1, which naturally looks like it's a true value. However, again, we have kind of forgotten one rule, right? Okay, so before we talk about that rule, we will run this code. Compile this code, we run this, and then the answer is false. So answer is false, it's not true, right? Why? Because we have forgotten a rule. By default, C language has an affinity for a double data type. So what does it mean? Whenever you have a floating point number, that floating point number, any number, 0.1, it will be treated like a double data type, right? Now we are storing that number into a float. And when you talk about two such notations, float versus double, okay, float has less degrees of precision, whereas double has a very high degrees of precision. Okay, float has, after decimal, we have 6.6 degrees of precision, whereas double has 10 points or 10 degrees of precision. So what happens is, even though we are storing a number 0.1 into a float, we are anyway storing it, not a problem. Okay, now when we look into this 0.1, this 0.1 is literally a double with higher degrees of precision. Okay, so it's a double data type with a higher degree of precision. Again, it's a comparison operator in C language. Both the operands must be of same data type. So this is double, so this has to be treated like a double. However, we have already stored 0.1 into a float data type, and it has a 6 degrees of precision. Okay, so we have 6 digit basically of precision after that decimal dot. So that value will be converted into a double. Now that double is not going to be the same as this double, because this will be literally 10 degrees of precision, or after the decimal we have 10 digits when we store it into the computer. So we have 10 digits of precision and this is 6 digits of precision. This is not going to be the same, and hence the answer will be false. As I told you, I am going to cover in more detail about the same example as I progress in my course on advanced programming, advanced C programming. Okay. Now let's look into the next one. Next one is again size of, right? Is again, it's a size of. So let's look into this, and we will try to deduce, try to come out with a correct answer. Okay, so this is the third one. So before I jump into the third one answer, right, what is the natural way in which people, all of us, try to solve this? Many people will look into this expression and then will say, okay, we are incrementing the b, it's a prefix operator. So b original value is 1, you can see it here. So b becomes 2. So b will be 2 is first answer. Similarly, b has become 2 and then we add 1 to it and the results get stored into c. So we will assume that c will have an answer 2 plus 1, 3. Right. Now the value of this is become 3. And the size of 3, so 3 is an integer. So as you know that integer is 4 bytes on a 32-bit system as well as on a 64-bit system. So size of integer is going to be 4. So size of returns 4. So we are going to store 4 in A. So you got A equal to 4, right? So these are some of the possible answers, way of solving problems, right? Basically, that a lot of us will look into. Now we will run this code, we'll compile this code and we will try to run this code, right? So we'll run this code and obviously you will see a different answer, right? So answer is always different in this case, because again, we are looking at the face, we are looking at the face on the screen, we are looking at the face value of the code, right? We have to understand what is the meaning of size of, how size of works, okay? See, size of is the compile time operand. Sorry, size of is a compile time operator, right? It's a compile time. So during compilation, it's going to deduce the result, the outcome of the computation in terms of memory sizes. So only during compilation, it's trying to evaluate it. But in runtime, it is not going to evaluate. It is never going to evaluate, because during runtime, the size of keyword itself will not be there in the compiled code, right? Instead, the return of size of, which is going to be 4, because size of f integer, right? So when you look into the arguments of this computation, right, what is c? C is an integer data type. B and 1, right? B is an integer and 1 is also by default an integer. So we are assigning some computations into an integer data type, okay? So the goal of size of is to really deduce what will be the result of the computation in terms of memory requirement size. Okay, so it's an integer, as we know, integer is 4 bytes. So during runtime, the code that you will see is generally this. What about C and plus plus B? They are just immaterial. They are never going to be there in the runtime. Only during compilation time, at the time of evaluation, when size of is really getting evaluated, it will look into this for computations. Okay, but during runtime, you can very well assume that this entire code is as it is, and in place of a equal to this large expression, it will be substituted with a equal to 4. So you have integer a, b equal to 1, c equal to 1, and a equal to 4, and then printf a, b, c, d, right? So what you really see is b and c are never going to change. It's never going to be changed, right? And the answer will be eventually what you have seen here, right? So the summary here is, yeah, we have to understand what's going on behind the scenes, actually, right? I will cover a little bit more about size of with more examples when I cover this topic in more detail, when I cover size of in more detail in my advanced C class. All right, so let's look into the next one now, right? So next one is character pointer. So we are going to talk about this character pointer. Okay, so do a cat, and then we'll do a code. So this is the code, and this is the character pointer. So what will be the answer? A lot of people will think that yes, it's a character pointer, and we initially assigned the value 0 into it, and now we are writing a character A. We are writing a character A into this memory location, and hence when I display the value, I should be able to display the value A. Let's compile this code. So when I compile this code, what's the output? We have a slightly different output. We get a segmentation fault and a core dump. So looks like this is not as expected. So there are some problems, okay? So before I explain the problem, let's try to understand the meaning of core dump a little bit more. Whenever we have illegal access in our program, illegal access means we are accessing a memory illegally. We are accessing a memory which we are never supposed to. Or we have access to a memory, but we are never supposed to read that. We are never supposed to write that. And we are writing that. So we'll have illegal access, okay? Whenever we have illegal access on a Linux platform, we get a sigsegv. We get a special signal, sigsegv, okay? So we have a segmentation violation. And that's the reason you are seeing an output on my Ubuntu. It's a segmentation fault. And if the environment is set in your system, so in my Ubuntu system, I have an environment set where a core file gets generated. So when you do an ls minus l, you will see a core file, right? This is a core file, and this core file is slightly big in size because it's a snapshot of the memory of the process. So we are running this a.out, right? We ran that a.out. So a.out is a process. So whenever it's an illegal memory access, the current process is aborted. It's not really aborted. Basically, it's a core dump. We are dumping the memory snapshot into a file called core for later troubleshooting, later analysis using GTB. Okay. So GDB and other debuggers for that matter. However, yeah, so this is a code file which gets generated only if your environment, you have set this to generate a core. Otherwise, it won't dump the code, okay? So keeping this aside, let's come back into the program. What's really going on into this program is, you know, what we are going to discuss, right? If you watch this carefully, this has a distinct meaning. What's the meaning here? Here we are saying that we are creating a pointer and that pointer is pointing to null. Lot of students take it wrong. They think that we have created a pointer variable and then we have assigned a value of zero or null into it. That is not true. Here if you really see that, what we have done is we have created a character pointer P. And what is P? P is pointing to null basically, okay? So this is a pointer, it is pointing to null. Null means zero, memory location zero. So in programming context, whenever we try to access the memory location zero, what is the meaning of star P here? We are jumping into that location and trying to write. This is known as indirection, as you know. So we are jumping into that memory location zero and trying to write the value A. So we are trying to do a write operation on memory address zero, technically. Right. So if you are trying to do a write operation on memory address zero, system will not support this. So it will reward you with a core dump basically, right? So we get a core dump. We cannot. So this never gets printed. The fault is here. So remember, this never gets printed. Okay. This is the fault. At this location, we get a core dump. That's the reason you don't see any printf in A.out. As I cover more about pointer in our advanced C, I'm going to cover a lot about pointers, okay, a lot about memory allocators, right, malloc, calloc, and lot of things, you know, about stack overflow, stack unwinding, right? So we'll talk a lot about pointers later. I will revisit this example with more explanation. Okay, so let's look into another example, you know, where we wanted to understand our own self-knowledge about C programming, okay? So let's go and then see this particular program. Now this program, I am sure many of you would have got it right. What would be the output? Okay, so here what we have a if condition. It's a nested if condition with an if and an else parameters, right? So if you see this, A greater than B, A is 1 and B is 3. So immediately when you say A greater than B, 1 is greater than B, 3. Answer is no. If the answer is no, we'll jump into the else condition and then we'll print something else, right? This will come to you as a first, hunch or a first guesswork when you look into this code as it is, right? So let's try to compile this code and try to see what is the potential output here, okay? So compilation is successful and what's the output? Output is practically nothing. And I told you, some of you who are reading this code more carefully, I am sure you understood why it is not something else, right? So what is wrong here? So first thing which is right here is we have done a very neat indentation. We have done a very neat indentation of this entire code, but we have a problem here, right? If you really look into this, if the condition is true, then we jump into this part, right? But if the condition is false, we have to jump into the else part. But do you think that this else condition belongs to this if or this if? So the real answer is this if, right? Because this else is part of this if. This else is part of this if. But the way I have coded it, I have just made it aligned here so that people get fooled, you know, into a coding method where we think, yeah, this is the else for this, which is not true. So we have done a neat indentation, but a deceiving indentation. Ideally speaking, this else should have been below this if and this printf should have come here, right? Okay. So we don't have an else condition for this particular if in this code and hence there is no output in this code. Right. So So what is the takeaway, you know? The takeaway for this particular set of exercise is for us to understand that we know C language, but how much do we really know? Do we really understand all the principles of the programming language, right? That is very important. C language is not just to code something on the screen, on your monitor, and then look at line by line and see whether that line is working or not. C language is much beyond that. It is a way of expressing your thought into a very carefully written, meaningful code. Not in terms of coding, in terms of performance, in terms of the logic and what goes on behind the scenes. Okay, so for that, you require a very subtle and good understanding of the programming language, right? If those who are watching this video, right, if you are able to really get the answers correct for all five of them with a solid logic supporting your answers, then I can certainly say that yes, you have a very good understanding of C programming language, and you will be, you know, much more mature, capable of doing a good industry grade C. Why? Because in the programming, when we think about C language, right, we do a lot of embedded work using C programming. The entire kernel is written in C. Compiler, think about any system software component, everything is C. And if our fundamentals are not clear, if we commit doing a lot of mistakes as depicted in some of these codes, then we will never be able to write a good software, okay? And the software will be so buggy that we'll be spending all our energy in a wrong code, not a neat code. It's a very different code. So some of you who have got 50% of this right, you know, in the first cut, you know, yeah, these are the answers, then I think it's good. And some of you who could not get all of these right, you know, you thought the answer is this, but in reality the answers were wrong, I think it's fine, because I have seen so many people in last 10 years of my training, you know, in SAN Foundry. Very few people understand the deep level of C programming, and that's the objective of this video, right? So I'm going to launch this course for benefit of everybody, and it's going to be very exhaustive, right? And hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of examples like this will be, you know, shown to all of you. And in the next set of slides, I'm going to now, you know, talk about the complete syllabus of advanced C programming. Please go through the syllabus, and you will see a lot of things, you know, which are there in the C language. Once you go through the C language, then we'll go module by module, or say chapter by chapter, and cover each one of these. To learn C programming further, we have a lot of resources at SAN Foundry. You can always subscribe to SAN Foundry YouTube channel, or you should visit sanfoundry.com website, where we have a massive collection of multiple choice questions and answers. We have close to 1700 multiple choice questions and answers. For that, you can always do a Google search, SAN Foundry CMCQs, or we have given the link below, sanfoundry.com/CInterview questions answers. Moreover, we also have thousands of C programs. These programs cater to a lot of different kind of students. We have programs for beginners, programs for advanced users, and we have tried to implement a lot of popular C programming algorithms and data structures using C language. So you can also do a SAN Foundry C program Google search. Besides this, if you do have queries about this video, or if you have any other queries related with C programming, you can always write your comment in the comment section below, so that I can create specific videos that will cater to your requirement. Thank you very much.